The program you're about to watch has a serious technical flaw. The first half, anyway. Very distorted audio. I find the problem about halfway through and correct it. I think I blame Skype. You ready for more stuff that you don't know what it is?
Yeah.
Wait a minute. I hear funny echo testing. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. Oh, just me going through your mic. Over into the other ear. I guess. Yeah, that's it. I can get used to it. Okay, another episode where you don't know what we're doing.
Okay.
Okay, then this is Ham Radio Now, episode 178. And, radio games. Radio games. Jeff says...
What radio games?
What are you talking about? Before we begin, let me... Because I always forget to do this at the beginning. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. Through the auspices of Arvin, our mascot back there, at hamradionow.tv. If you enjoy these programs, Jeff, do you enjoy these programs?
Oh, I do. I've seen some.
You've seen one or two. Or 179.
No, I've seen half a dozen or more.
Wow.
And I've heard more than that, just going to Dayton and back.
All the way through?
Yeah, yeah.
To the very end?
Well, the ones we go to Dayton and back, yeah.
Because I play them in the car.
Yeah.
All right. Anyway, Arvin sitting back there. If you enjoy the programs, hamradionow.tv. And I'll say a little bit more about that coming up in a couple of minutes. But radio games, I've lost my notes. I need to get back to my notes. Are you my notes? Yeah. That says 178. 178?
Is this? Yeah, 178. Okay. Is this like WRTC radio games?
In a sense, yeah, kind uh-huh. of. This is a fever dream. Well, not a dream. You ever woke up like 3 o'clock in the morning, can't go back to sleep, your brain is racing and just thinking about things.
I always wake
things.
Up at 3 a.m. and can't go back to sleep until I,
you go pee.
Yeah.
Yes.
Actually, that's the second of 3 times up in the morning at 3 o'clock.
You're going to be what at your next birthday? You just turned 59.
Yeah, I'm going to be 60.
Okay. I just turned 65, so. How come you have gray hair and I don't?
Raising kids. Before I had kids, I didn't have gray hair.
Yeah, only my hairdresser knows for sure. So this is one of those fevered 3 o'clock in the morning things. We need kids in ham radio. Everybody says we need kids. In the last episode, talking to Adam, you know, that thing that happens in the board meeting, somebody raises their hand and say, we should do something. Well, about every other board meeting in a radio club I've ever been to, somebody raised their hand. We need to do something to get more kids in ham radio.
Oh, it's not just ham radio. It's every hobby.
Stamp collecting and model trains.
You name it.
You do model planes.
Yeah.
These days, they call them drones. they change the name.
Yeah. Yeah.
What's up with that?
And they have trouble getting young people in.
Really, it's something as cool as that, and they have trouble getting young people.
Cost of equipment, yeah.
Okay. So we need more young people in ham radio. So I'm thinking, and we talked about this before we started recording the previous episode a little bit. So I know that you're going to poo-poo this idea in advance.
I don't know that.
Well, you did then. You may have changed your mind by now.
Okay.
So what I'm thinking of is that what do kids do, technologically interested, not necessarily even astute, but kids that are somewhat interested in technology, the kind of kids that when I was young, when I was 15, got into ham radio because there wasn't very much else to get into for technology at that point. Now there's a lot of things, and what do they do?
Well, computer-related things.
Yeah.
Or tablet-related things.
Yeah, and as I was trying to get you to be specific about it, we're talking about...
Yeah, gaming.
They like
gaming.
Video games.
Mm-hmm.
And so what I was thinking of is we have gaming in ham radio. We have a ton of it. I wanted to do some research before I started this episode, but I just ran out of time. Because I wanted to comb through some of the early QSTs and see when contesting began. That's what we call our game.
Yeah, that'd be interesting.
Yeah. It's going to be out there somewhere because they probably didn't call it contesting
at first. ask what ham radio is.
I don't have Siri, but I've got the Google. When did ham radio contesting begin? I'm just not gonna know. What did ham radio contest again? Those are the words it came up with. I got it too bright. Dim this thing. When did ham radio contest again? So anyway.
Shall I try?
But it's showing contest basics. You know, it's taking me to ARRL right away and talking about contesting. Sure, try it with Siri.
All right. When did ham radio contesting begin?
Let me check on that. Okay, I found this on the web for when did ham radio contest thing begin.
At least got the right words.
More or less. When did ham radio contest thing begin?
Yeah, close.
You got.
Yeah, but what does it say?
It was a bunch of web pages is all.
Okay. ARRL right off the bat?
Wikipedia and then ARRL.
Okay. So, yeah, that's going to be too obscure, I think, for any web search.
Yep.
But QST, it would take a while to go through the old QSTs, which anybody, any ARRL member can now do, all the way back to the first one in 1915. And I'm going to guess that something got started by the early mid-20s. Yeah. Field day pretty much was in the 30s.
Was that always a contest?
You're
a long-time ham.
Yes.
40, 50, 60 years.
As a matter of fact, we are 1 month away from 50 years.
50, oh, wow. Yeah. My
novice license was in 1965.
So the flavor of Field January. Day now, it's really, there's a dichotomy there. A lot of people see it as a contest. Others see it as not at all a contest, an introduction to amateur radio for the general public. It goes along with the ARRL message and all. How has that changed over the years? Was it always kind of like it is now?
I think I read some QST articles describing early Field Days, and it's been a while, and we know how good my memory is. So what I vaguely recall is that it was some of both. I think it was more a field exercise at the very beginning. But we have going on right now, just concluding in some areas, the simulated emergency test,
mm-hmm.
not a contest,
mm-hmm.
pure exercise.
Right.
Who participates? Small handful of people.
Yeah.
Small handful of highly motivated hams that really want to get into the emergency communications.
Right.
So field day is the way it's set up now is the way it has to be. Because otherwise it's not going to get as many people into it as it does. So yeah, maybe they don't learn serious emergency procedures really well. But
they're getting on the air. That's okay with me.
Yeah, but they do get out there and discover that you got to put the power poles red to red and black to black,
yeah.
and that you can reverse power poles if you put them in wrong.
Yeah,
and they're not polarized to begin with, so you can screw up.
Yep,
that happened to me one time. One of our local guys. Had a power supply that he was going to loan me to use with a power pole built onto it, and looked at it carefully, and he had done it backwards.
Oh my goodness!
Yeah. So
he built the power supply.
No, but he built the cable.
Oh, okay.
Connected it to the power supply. Handed me the little power. You know,
from Power Works, you can get those power poles with the red and the black pieces permanently joined,
welded together.
Now, yeah.
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 Probably a good idea.
I've gone through 200 sets of those in the last 4 days.
With your Christmas tree lights.
Yeah.
So you're using power poles on Christmas. You're not allowed to use power poles in anything but ham radio.
Guilty. It's because I use DC to run the Christmas lights. They're LEDs. When they run on AC, they flicker. And Bobby tells me she can't see that flickering, but I can look down the street and see the whole neighborhood, and you can pick out which ones are LEDs because of it.
Explain to people what that's all about.
Well,
ladies and gentlemen, it is now time for smoke and bismuth.
Christmas,
you know why I called it smoke and bismuth?
Yeah.
Because I can't call it smoke and solder. That's a registered trademark of Ham Radio, Ham Nation, yeah. And Amateur Logic TV.
Yeah. Well, LEDs, you know, they're diodes, so they only conduct on the positive half of the AC cycle, or on one half of the AC cycle, depending on how the diode is turned, and not even that whole 180 degrees, because it has to reach the voltage where they all become forward biased to even turn on at all. So I guess you get conduction for probably somewhere between 100 and 150 degrees or so of the AC cycle. So most of the time, the lights are off. Sometime they're on, somewhere probably between 30 and 40% of the time they're on. And 60 hertz sounds like a real fast rate to be flashing the lights, but a lot of people can see them, especially if the lights are moving. So I built some full-wave bridge rectifiers, so mine are on twice every AC cycle, and you can't see that flicker. And if you move them a lot, like if you're swinging them around in a circle, they'll trace a dotted line.
Are you putting any filtering in? Are you trying to make it pure DC, or are you just doing a
No filtering at all. It's just pulsating DC, but it's pulsing, 120 hertz instead of 60 hertz. Okay. So
now, does that make it brighter?
You don't see that. Well, it would, but I put series resistance in every one. The frame around my house, I think I counted 912 lights, and they take about 53 watts.
So not much power.
Now about 8 milliamps, between 7 and 8 milliamps per bulb, okay. I think it was.
So
that's a lot of power poles, yeah. Though.
If you you got a power pole on every one of them.
They're all over the place, yeah.
So if you didn't put the resistance in, would the LED have trouble? Would it burn out or just be too bright?
Some would be brighter than others depending on the length of the string. See, all the strings are cut to the length so they'll fit around the windows with no extra bulbs, So the length of the string determines how much resistance there has to be, so they're all the same brightness.
We just bunch up whatever's extra and kind of stuff it out of sight.
Yeah, I know you do. on all two strings you put up.
Yes. Yeah, and the Christmas tree that we... it's a two-story house, and so there's a shelf above, cathedral ceiling in the lobby, the foyer, and there's a shelf above the front door. We have a Christmas tree sitting up there all year long. You can see it, but it's dark, so it doesn't really show up as a Christmas tree until now. And we flip a switch that turns on a timer. We wait till 5 o'clock, flip the switch. Turns on the timer, and the tree lights up from 5 o'clock until 11 p.m.
Oh, nice. I didn't know about the timer. I knew about the switch.
Yeah. It'd be too much work to remember to turn it on and off.
Yeah. Get up. Yeah. Is there anything on that tree besides lights, or is it
no,
just lights?
No, just lights. No just tinsel. Lights. Yeah. Mm. But it looks pretty out there. We got an email from a neighbor that said, your tree looks pretty. So what was this episode about again?
Contesting.
Oh, well, yeah. We call it contesting, and I'm thinking that, this is not something that I have the power to change. Kind of like the way I did 60 meters, if we ever do a 60 meter band, it's going to be all channelized because I said it ought to be. It's not going to happen.
It is channelized.
But if we get a band.
Oh.
Yeah. Still working on that, by the way.
Oh.
Yeah. It's still, I want to gather some brain power around and do a show about that because it's still working its way through the various administrations and everybody's coming up with a slightly different plan.
Yeah.
Here in the United States, our NTIA says, nah, I think your five channels is enough. You don't need any more. You're fine. We don't care what the rest of the world
does. Who's NTIA?
The National Telecommunications Information Agency. It's the FCC of the federal government.
Oh, I thought the FCC was.
The FCC regulates communications for the private sector and for state and below of the public sector, state police, local police departments, fire departments, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Their communications is all regulated by the FCC. But military and government communications, federal government communications, is regulated by the NTIA.
And
between the NTIA and the FCC, they have carved the spectrum up like a Halloween pumpkin. I hope people watch the last show and get that reference. And so NTIA controls what's around 5 megahertz. So now we've got this proposal going on for a ham band, an actual band. We wanted 5 megahertz spectrum because propagation between 80 meters and 40 meters was not very good in the daytime. There would be a gap. 80 meters would fall short. 40 meters would be a little too long. Yeah. And in the 100, 150, 200 to 300 mile range, signals could not propagate sometimes. Sometimes it did, but sometimes they wouldn't. So the spectrum in between is likely to then have propagation. This is a daytime thing. By the way, nobody uses 60 meters in the daytime. Nobody. Listened a lot. Nobody uses it in the daytime. But that was our story, and we're sticking to it. So we pleaded our case, and the NTIA said, okay, 5 channels, one of which had a permanent data signal on it. So they eventually moved it after we said, excuse us, but we can't use that channel. We're secondary, you know, it's not a ham band.
Right.
But now there's the push worldwide. It's coming up in the next World Telecommunications Conference. It used to be the WARC, now it's just the WTC, mm-hmm. WRC, World Radio Conference. Which is a year away, next November, in Geneva, probably. So proposal has been made for a worldwide ham band. The size of it and the rest of the parameters still very much in flux, but right. We're looking at somewhere between 1 and 200 kilohertz for that. And various governments have weighed in with proposals. They're ham societies and the IARU and I'm not very good expert on all the various pieces of this puzzle, but I've listened to the guys who are with rapt attention as I'm doing shows with them. So everyone's weighing in with what they're suggesting, and the FCC had a notice of inquiry, I guess, is probably what it was, saying what do we want here in the U.S. And that's where I put in my concept for make it all channelized. You know, I actually filed comments that said, let's make it all channelized, which nobody else thought was a good idea. What a surprise. I won't go into that. It's still a good idea. So at that time, the NTIA said, yeah, okay. But then it came time for them to speak with a clear voice, and they said, Nah, we think if 5 channels you've got are fine. You don't need more. And so we don't know what the U.S. government is going to say. We got the FCC saying a band.
Right.
NTIA saying no band.
Right.
And keep your 5 channels. And the rest of the world pretty much saying a band, but nobody knows quite what the band is going to be. So next year, this will come up at the WRC. It'll be a very minor thing. It's not what they're getting all the nations in the world together to discuss radio about. But it will be a little thing at this big thing. And we may end up with a worldwide ham band, at which point the FCC can make rules for the U.S.
Okay.
So we may have a 60-meter band. NTIA be darned.
Cool.
Or not.
Will contesting be allowed on it?
We were talking about contesting, weren't we?
An hour or so, a good while ago.
Probably not, because it'll be one of those work band things
right.
where we keep the contests off. We keep the contests off those bands for a couple of good reasons. One, they're narrow bands. Yeah. All of those bands that we got back in the 70s at the WARC, mm-hmm. 12 meters, 17 meters. Oh, yeah, meters.
The three new work bands.
Three new work bands that you don't have on your band switch because you're running a Heath kit. they're narrow, 50 or less than 100 kilohertz wide, so not really enough room to seriously contest. But they also created a place to go if you don't want to contest.
Yeah,
isn't it fun on field day? You're tuning, you're teaching people, new people, the go to station, especially you're tuning and you're tuning and tuning. It's contester, rag chew.
Yeah,
and just. Doesn't take long, but the new guys, they don't get it. So they're listening for a while. They don't seem to be contesting. When are they going to turn it over? Well, my lumbago has been kicking up once again. So I do.
Yeah.
And all you damn contesters.
Mm-mm. Yep.
So, all right, no. No contesting on 60 meters, I declare it, on the channels that we have. Children, kids, get off the lawn, damn kids. The kids do video games. The hams do, and wait for it.
I want that ham
radio games. We call it. Why did I turn into a tent? Don't know yet. Radio games. All right. I think it's a branding thing. If we don't talk about it as contesting, mm-hmm. but we change it to a name that will sound vaguely familiar and perhaps even have a cool factor, maybe we will interest the young folks who are very much into video games.
I wasn't so sure you were serious before we talked an hour or so ago, but now I'm starting to think you are.
I am.
Change it from contesting to gaming.
Well, we're never going to. No, we know that hams don't change. Hams are resistant to change.
But you think changing the name will help entice young people?
Well, adding the name. Like I said, we're never going to change it. Mm-hmm. I don't remember when this happened, if you were paying attention. There was a point when the AR, you know what the ARRL stands for?
ARRL, yeah.
Yeah, the AARL. You know what the initials stand for?
Yeah.
Go ahead and tell everybody.
Oh, the American Radio Relay League.
Okay, do you know what that means?
One ham sending a radiogram to the next to try to get it across the country and back. Started out as a kind of an interesting challenge.
Started out as something that had to be done that way.
Yeah.
Hasn't been the case for, once again, 50 years in January of 2015. I think my first contact was like on back then, you had to wait till you got the license in the mail.
Yeah.
And it took about 12 weeks from the time that my novice test was sent in to license appeared in the mailbox. I think that was around January 5th. So officially, I've got a log. I don't have that license anymore. It was in my wallet, which was stolen from my college dorm.
Oh, dear.
But probably the most important piece of paper to me in my entire life, my original. That would have been my general license. Might have even been my advanced. No, it would have been a general. I don't know what happened to the novice. I wasn't good at keeping paper back then. In any case, I don't have the license anymore, but I do have the log books. And the first contact was log. You had to log back then. Log everything. Log CQs. Log. I had to stop talking because I sneezed for a minute. Put it in the log.
I didn't know.
Got that. I exaggerate a little for emphasis.
Oh.
So, I forgot where I was going. Even back 50 years ago, we called it contesting. No, that wasn't where I was going. I'll have to rewind the tape and see what I was trying to talk about.
Well, I think what you were about to say is that you think young people would be more interested in contesting if it wasn't called contesting, but rather called something with which they're a little more familiar, like gaming.
Yeah, that's only the foot in the door. Mm-hmm. You know, it's maybe barely the big toe in the door.
Yeah.
Because if you start by saying, well, we have ham radio, and in ham radio, we've got something you're going to be interested in. It's contesting. Blank expression.
Yeah.
No comprehension.
Yeah.
We got this thing called ham radio, which is really cool. And we got part of it that we think you might be interested in, radio gaming.
So they ask, what's that?
All right. Well, you are one giant leap ahead of where you were with what?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, what I'm wondering, though, is what you're going to tell them or what you're going to do after they try it for about 15 minutes and discover it's more boring than death to most people.
Do you think that if somebody is seriously into video games, that there's no correlation to what we do in ham radio contests?
Oh, yes, I think that for sure.
Really?
I do.
Well, I'm not a contester. You know, I dabble. And I'm not a video gamer. I played Pong.
Oh.
And I skipped. What was the next, the really big one that followed that? So things would fall from the
Breakout.
No, it's a Space Invaders. Yeah, I skipped that.
Okay,
I think I jumped straight to Doom. So a PC game.
Okay,
And Cindy will tell you that I was fairly addicted to Doom for a couple of months. She might say 6 months. I think it was a few weeks, but it was one of those, a couple of hours or more every evening.
Mm-hmm.
I had better things to do, and I was doing that instead. It was very cool, very, very addictive.
Yeah,
I think I would enjoy them. I just don't have time. They're not up on my list high enough. But from that experience, I see lots of correlation between what you do with video games and what you're doing in a ham radio contest. Let me see if I can stretch your imagination here.
Okay.
Especially multiplayer games. The single-person shooter games, yeah, probably not so much. But even so, your goal on a single-person shooter game is a bad guy pops up and you push a button and you shoot them. Your goal in a contest is a signal pops up and you push a button and you call them. When you shoot them in a game, as the degree of difficulty gets more and more difficult, you may or may not hit them. When you call them on the radio, you may or may not get them. You may or may not get an answer. I think those parallels extend pretty far. You keep looking at me like I have grown a third eye.
No, the parallels work real well with words. But when you put it into practice, I don't see it being the same.
You think that the noise might be an issue?
No, I think the lack of action might be an issue. What's a good rate for a beginning contester?
Well, beginning contesters and beginning gamers both do poorly. Although probably games are designed to addict you fast. So, yeah, ham radio.
If ham radio was, I'd agree a lot more with what you're saying.
Then maybe we need to do more than just a modification of the branding. I mean, if we're serious.
Oh, yes, I definitely agree.
If we are serious about wanting young people in, then we can't hold tooth and nail to the old ways of doing things.
That's for sure.
I mean, we don't have to let the old ways go. We just have to add something that's going to work. So how might it work?
Make a contest 15 minutes instead of 48 hours. Where people do not have the attention span they had.
But gamers do. Gamers will sit there all night. By all night, I mean the sun comes up and they got to go to work.
Yes, using software that was designed to be addictive. Ham radio was not designed to be addictive.
Well, it is for some of us.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Very few, though.
Well, okay. You can see where the loggerheads that we are at. If that is the case.
Even in ham radio, contesting is not big. How many hams in the U.S., roughly?
Well, there's about 730,000 licenses, but the active number is an unknown figure.
Okay.
Mostly guessed at somewhere well south of half.
And what percentage would you say are contesters?
Oh, yeah, okay, so it might be 10, 20,000, 30,000.
Contesters?
Yeah.
I only see a couple of hundred entries in the QST listings.
In the big ones?
A few hundred, then.
Okay.
From the U.S.
The CQ Worldwide?
It's been so long since I've looked at the results, I don't know. Thousands.
Yeah, it may be 1,000 or so.
So it's a niche interest in ham radio where the diehards already are.
Never mind.
There may be a way to attract young people. There may be a way to attract young people to ham radio, but I don't know that calling contesting gaming is going to do it.
Well, I mean that's not going to be the whole thing, but that be part of it.
Yeah.
What else did I say here? Oh, make them more. Here we go. Make them more like video games.
Oh yeah, that would be good.
This to do this is going to require some online integration with everybody who's operating, because this is going to have to set things up so that the world of contesters is on exactly the same page at the same moment. So this can't be all radio. It has to be by your an online thing, a poison contact and a golden contact. See where I'm going here?
Yeah, well, it sounds interesting. I mean, I'm not sure I see where you're going, but they sound like great ideas
already.
You're
making as many contacts as you can, and, you know, rolling along, and somebody calls you, and you answer them, and you push the button. It's not the very end of your logging cycle. You got to push the button somewhere in the middle, and your screen goes red, and you go, "Sorry, old man, I'm a poison contact." You lose X hundred contacts, all right, off your log. They're gone from your log. There's no appeal. His log just is online, and 500 contacts just disappeared. I was a poison contact.
Maybe 10 contacts.
Oh, well, okay, we don't have to work out the details right now.
Yeah, okay, well, I think that would be an interesting twist to contesting. That would be fun.
Bing. Good luck, guy. I'm a golden contact. I am worth 10 points, 500 points, whatever.
Good.
You know, in the CQ worldwide, you know, people are making millions of points, not millions of contacts, but they're scoring in the millions of points.
Yeah.
You know, I'm good for 1,000 points. You know, it just popped up. I didn't know it was going to happen. You didn't know it was going to happen. You know, so those are the things that happen in video games that, you know, we could add.
Yeah.
I'm not going to come up with all the ideas here. You got to contribute something. What else do I have here? Here's somebody trying to do something. This isn't exactly a contest. It's more of an activity. And I really ought to give this guy a call sometime and do a show with him. Radar, the rapid deployment of amateur radio. I don't know if this would be one of those things that gets a lot of kids interested right away or not. But what he's doing is they call a specific time, and you take equipment into the field. And, you know, the KX3s and the KX3s and the ASU 8, 817, it's a little portable ones.
Yeah.
And you set up and you make some contacts. And then you got to move someplace else, a good distance away, a kilometer away, I think is what they're talking about, and make some more contacts.
That does sound like fun.
And you got a limited amount of time to do this in. So, it's getting you to do things.
I would participate in that.
Well, you can.
That sounds like fun.
Here you go. Let's see, multi-discipline promotes the use of all methods of communications available. Basic survival methods. You're not exactly a survivalist, but you're a gun nut, so it's sort of the same thing. Exchange of useful information. Navigation, grid squares and locations. Yeah, so you can read that and get the idea what it's all about.
Okay.
So, somebody out there is thinking.
Yep.
Again, I don't know if that's attracting young people or not. But
I don't know. Would it be difficult for young people to participate in it?
If they can't drive, they can bike. Get on the subway. They're urban. I don't know exactly all the parameters. I'll talk to Greg sometime.
Yeah, that sounds interesting. And that would be good.
We'll figure it out. So anyway, that's the idea of
that's radio, your best idea.
Radio gaming.
Yeah.
In my fevered dream last night, I got on my tablet and I registered the web name theradiogames.com. So I've got that, theradiogames.com. You can't get radiogames.com. That's some Russian site. I don't know what. Can't read what it says.
The Radio Games.
The Radio Games. Remember, we saw The Hunger Games. So that's. Remember, we saw that just the other day.
Oh, yeah. The movie.
Yeah. So like that, but The Radio Games.
Okay.
You know, all kinds of different names would be more popular, you know, radio gaming or something like that, some version.
Maybe some elements of the Hunger Games in
oh yeah, where people
radio sport would make it more interesting.
Well, that's why I'm thinking, about as far as we're going to be able to go is the poison contact.
Yeah.
Well, okay, everyone is required to hold a pair of test leads. And if you get the poison contact, how far do you want to go with this? Do you just, you feel it or you fall over? And knowing some of the hams we got, the feel it part is also the fall over part.
Yeah.
You got to be careful with this stuff.
Yeah. Be careful
what you ask for. You just might get it. Okay. So speaking of ham radio games in the field, this is why I was ending up with, have I got the right button there? Yeah. There we go. Looking like a tent.
Yeah.
It looks like field day, but it's not. It's a Jota. Bill Carley, KC2ZFO, sent me email and said, I've got some Jota pictures. Would you like them? And I said, well, tell me what they're all about. And yeah, we'll take a look at them. So, he sent me a bunch. We'll take a look at them here. This is just the tent in their backyard. He's in Middletown, New York. And that's the station that they set up. It looks, you know, for all the world, like a field day station. Let me punch them up full screen. They're using an Eagle One vertical antenna. This isn't the best player for this. I'm using VLC, which is okay. You're not seeing cool. You're not seeing the see over here. When I bring this up, the little play bar shows up, but you guys aren't seeing it.
No, that's good.
In the online version. Well, fine. I won't worry about that. Okay, Eagle One antenna. So they're just running a vertical antenna. Oops. And they had, you can see just barely here, a whole bunch of radials. Yeah. How many did you say? 16 radials. So radials are important for a vertical. And this is Bill over here. And his nephew, Julius, is the fellow sitting and looking pretty darn happy about it. And Kyle, and they're both Boy Scouts. Out of uniform there, Boy Scouts. In the middle is Bill's sister, Michelle, who is KB2 NTX. Yeah. And how did you know that?
On her hat.
Oh. I'm trying to read my my Evernote note, which is way off to the side here. I'm having a hard time doing it. Let's see. What else have they got? That's Julius after his first contact, so clearly very excited about that. And making more contacts, and the excitement never fades. Eating pizza, even more exciting than making contacts. He's calling this a lull in the action. And then it's Bill and Michelle again, and his wife, XYL, Jennifer, KD2BCB, I guess she would be in the foreground there. The boys are having more pizza. Bill can't not operate, so he's chasing some special event stations. And finally, that is Michelle's sweatshirt.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
Yeah. So what is it? Explore Your World Ham Radio. So yeah, there's a lot of cool stuff out there. So he sent them to me, and I thought, well, what the heck? We'll stick them on ham radio now.
That was Middletown, New York.
Yeah.
Well done, Middletown.
But
or
okay,
Bill.
So Jota. Yep. Julian looks excited, but I've heard lots of Jota contacts. I imagine you've heard a bunch of Jota contacts.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's all in who you get. Your experience is all in who you get. We've operated Jota events from my house where scouts have come over, and it's extremely variable.
Yeah. What could make it better? I guess...
Oh, just
finding hams to talk to.
Who if the ham you get is going to go through his equipment list and how high his antenna is and all of that, you're not going to have a good day. If he's going to tell about how his city of Sacramento might be different from our city of Raleigh, and you know how he's getting ready for lunch, even though we're getting ready for dinner and things like that, it's going to be a lot more interesting.
Oh, time zones.
Oh, that sort of thing.
I have to admit something. The last episode with Adam out in Portland, I wanted to do the show at 2 o'clock, and he said he'd be available at 9 or so, and I said, well, let's go for 10 o'clock your time, 2 o'clock my time.
Uh-oh.
Anybody should know time zones. So 1 o'clock, he's calling me up, and I'm at lunch. I've got you scheduled to come in at 2 o'clock, or I would have rushed home and at least done it earlier. Oh, he was very accommodating. He's very polite.
Oh.
So.
Yep.
10 o'clock your time, 1 o'clock. West Coast, East Coast.
Yep.
Yes. Oh, dear.
So maybe that would be a useful discussion.
Yeah. Well, I stay on top of them because I cross them almost every week.
So if you're doing a Jota thing, hard part is the ham who is being the contact.
Yeah.
Being the coach or the guy who is helping out, you can intervene and make some of that work better. But you are somewhat limited by who you're going to talk to. And boy, we are bad to that. Just terrible.
Yep.
And it is not easy. You know, I've tried, and I'm racking my brain to think of something. And I think viewers of this program have recognized that I'm not bad at asking questions. But I'm kind of thinking on my feet and staying engaged in what's going on. And well, there's the age gap between me and I see a lot of young kids on Ham Radio Now. It's almost because I don't know how to ask them questions. That's really not it. But well, I did talk to the 5-year-old. Ethan, at the Charlotte Ham Fest a couple years ago, he'd just gotten his tech at age 5.
Yeah.
You know, and don't ask the stupid questions. Don't ask the stupid questions. Ethan, stupid question. Next stupid question. Didn't know how to do better questions.
Yeah.
So it's hard. They have, we probably ought to, and you know, I guess this would be really on the Boy Scouts if they want to make this really good. Give us a list of questions. Every ham has this list of questions. Just, you know, and it's got to be more than 5.
So why questions?
To ask the other scout. Well, or things you could tell them about. You know, topics or questions. Telling them things is probably not as good as asking them things that they have to be drawn out and talk about with more than a yes or no answer.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you having a good time at Jota? Yeah. Back to you. You want to become a ham? Yeah.
And that's probably a question we shouldn't ask.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. Unless you're just getting 100% positive feedback about, whoa, this radio stuff is as cool as it can get. But they never say that.
No. Jota's like any other place where people are exposed to, where non-hams are exposed to ham radio. The very, very few that want to become one will make themselves known right away. You can tell.
Probably. They might need a little bit of encouragement. I mean, kids are very variable. And you know, I was a wallflower kid.
Yeah. And I didn't specifically mean kids, but
I would have been desperate to do something like that. And yet you wouldn't have heard me say anything about it. You know, I probably wouldn't have gotten on the mic. You know, I'd sat in the background saying, please ask me, please ask me, please ask me.
See, then 20 years later, there were a lot of people that wished you still wouldn't, from what I've heard.
Yes, that's very true. That's very true. So, speaking of, the last thing we were looking at was, I have to make my connection here. The last thing we were looking at was Michelle's sweatshirt. So, speaking of sweatshirts, there we go. This is not a commercial. I don't make any money off of this. Tom has offered me a little bit of money for each shirt that he sells, but I don't really need it. A couple of bucks from each shirt doesn't make much difference, especially considering the number of shirts that he sold, which is not very many. But this is the holiday season coming up, and if you're looking for a gift for the ham who has everything, well, here's something that they don't have. And if they're watching this show, there's a pretty good chance that they are a fan of Ham Radio Now. In fact, you are the ham that is watching the show. You're going to have to put this in front of the person who is desperately trying to figure out something for you that is not going to break the bank, that you don't already have and that you might be interested in. So it would be a t-shirt, a sweatshirt, or a hoodie with the logo of your favorite ham radio program on it. They got anything else down here? No, that's pretty much it. That's what they got. These guys have a lot of stuff for some, you know, generic stuff, and then they do stuff for your radio club. So
Can you go back to the starting page? It was something didn't make sense on one of them. This, the resistance is futile.
Oh,
it doesn't have a switch. Doesn't make sense. Yeah, it would be futile if there was a switch bypassing the resistor or something else or frequency source. Well, yeah, but it's not exactly like that, right?
We have to talk to Tom about his design.
That just doesn't make sense.
Yeah, because that resistance that he's displaying there
is quite viable.
Yeah, two parallel resistors. Maybe they were
series. They were
two series resistors. I'm an extra class ham. Can't you tell? So two series resistors. Maybe they were only like an eighth of an ohm.
Still not futile.
Well, it depends on what you're trying to do.
Yeah, yeah. So it could be. It could be.
Yeah, that's it. They were an eighth of an ohm. Couldn't you tell?
But that joke
wouldn't make much of a joke. No,
no, I couldn't tell, and the joke was utterly missed.
Yeah, the T-shirt that you're thinking of. Well, I'll put you a full screen on camera. You can sort of describe it.
Oh well, it's can you? No, I'll describe it using words. It has a resistor on there, but there is a switch bypassing the resistor, and the switch is closed. So in that sense, resistance is futile because it's shorted out by a switch. And so the joke makes sense.
And you're saying it wrong, by the way. Resistance is futile.
Futile? Okay.
Futile. And you know where that comes from, that expression?
Yeah. Star Trek, the Borg.
Okay.
Now and then at work, I get on
totally useless.
The PA and call, you know, all phone text to the assimilation chamber immediately.
All right. So you're not totally useless. You haven't totally kind of lost everything.
Yeah.
Hang on a second. I got to look at something here. I'm not happy. I haven't been looking at the audio levels.
You were supposed to sing on episode 178, too.
Yeah.
I suggest the liver song.
I hate the bird, it makes me quiver, it makes me go right up and down, makes me cry. Well, maybe you just haven't had it cooked right.
Oh, man. Probably have been recording fairly distorted audio for a long time, and I don't know why it changed, but it did. So now here, deep into episode 179, I fixed it. There's a little audio meter on Wirecast that, it's way down here. You can't see it top screen.
I can see it.
Yeah, and it is dependent on Windows behaving itself, and I set the audio levels and didn't change anything before we started.
Started acting up.
I bet Skype changed it.
Was it? I hope it was okay at the end of the last episode.
Well, I don't know. We'll see.
Okay,
it'll be a little. We get a little peak distortion all the way through. Wearing these great big fat headphones doesn't help because I don't hear the audio that's being recorded in Wirecast. And the reason I don't listen to it is, I could. But if I listen to Wirecast, there's latency, and so I'd be hearing myself delayed by a quarter second or so. And I would talk like this for the entire program.
That would be bad.
It would be hard. Although, you know, folks that stutter, if they are fed audio and headphones of themselves, not delayed that much, but just barely delayed, stutter goes away.
Really?
For some of them.
Oh, that's interesting.
It's an interesting something that was discovered a few years or a couple decades ago.
Oh.
So, I don't know. Meanwhile.
Well, that's a mighty fine apparel you got there.
Okay. So, yes. So, hamshirts.com. And if you are just absolutely stuck for an idea to suggest to your spouse, a kid. Kid especially, because that's, you know, they're cheap enough that a kid can afford one, mm-hmm. or that it won't hurt you too badly if you're actually paying for your kid to give you a Christmas present.
Yeah.
So anyway, one more time, hamshirts.com. And again, that's not a commercial because I don't make anything off of it, but it's cool. I was going to try to edit that interview that we did at Dayton. with the guy, the one guy that wore the Ham Radio Now t-shirt.
Yeah.
And you were there, even though you weren't working with me at Dayton this year. You were there at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And that's coming. It will come. If you're waiting to see yourself, that will happen. I know it'll happen.
Who's here? Come on, bear.
The bear is back. There he is. The bear is back. He's big and he's bad.
Yeah.
He's talking to the mic, bear? The bear doesn't make very much noise. He doesn't meow. Once in a while, he purrs a little bit. It's rare, but once in a while. Okay, you can sit there for a while if you want. Be calm. Next. We have been promoting the idea of using Weed Eater Line.
Yeah.
Where did it go? Well, it was here.
Here it is.
My fingers are all weird from working with a bunch of wires here the last few days.
We have been...
Got no feeling in them.
Ooh, that's not good.
They're numb. Well, I don't think it's bad. You know, I've been hard pinching and splitting and...
Don't do that. We have been promoting the idea of using Weed Eater Line as antenna support for several years now. And since we have been promoting it, I am loath to admit anytime there's any kind of a problem because we've been telling you it's a good idea. And I know that there are thousands of dipoles now floating high and proud above ham shacks across not only America but the entire world.
Yeah.
Anywhere Weed Eater Line is available at a hardware store near you.
Yeah.
Supported by Weed Eater Line. My dipole fell down the other day.
Well, I don't think you ever claimed that it was, you know.
It had been up about a year. Not as long as everybody wanted it to be.
Yeah, they usually make it quite a bit longer than that.
Yes. Yeah, we've seen it. And this was a particularly long stretch of line. And I think I saw what happened. First of all, let me show the line here. This is, if I can find the focal point, that's what it looks like at its primary, normal width. And as I slide it down, you will see it get thinner and thinner and thinner until it reaches the end. And it isn't really hollow, although that little bit at the end there is kind of hollow. So, once again, it's kind of thick. Stay in front of the camera. And it gets... I'm not really holding it well enough. I'm going closer and farther from the camera, and the size seems to be changing.
You know, it looks like it's quite oval, too. It's flat on one side.
It's very oval. So, it's been stretched. So, back to... Well, let me just do my camera here. It got... This is the end that broke, and it... Just stretched about this much of it here. It looks very stretched. And what appears to have happened is that it goes up over the branch of a tree and eventually slides down right into the elbow and the crook between the trunk and the branch. And the tree grows. And eventually it grew around it and just took a good tight hold of the Weed Eater Line.
Yeah.
So there was about 70 feet less. It's very stretchy. This stuff is very stretchy when you get 100 feet of it or so. So as the wind blows, it becomes something of a spring. But it lost 70 feet of that stretch because it was really stuck tight in that at that point. I think it was just
stretching a few feet past between the branch and the insulator.
Yeah, it still had more like 50 feet. Still a lot to stretch, but... But you can tell that it really got stretched hard because this stuff is hard to break. But it did.
Now, that was part of the part that came down with the antenna. Is the other end still up in the tree?
Yeah, I tugged as hard as I could on that end, and I couldn't pull it out of the tree.
Yeah.
It took my 180 pounds. Used to be 100. Well, it used to be 200 and a quarter. Then it used to be 170. Now it's 180. Okay.
You dog.
Yeah. So it took that and I couldn't pull out of the tree. Yeah. So it was holding tight.
Yep.
So you came by with your bow and arrow.
Yeah.
We didn't shoot this on video or it would have taken all day. and shot another line, and this time I doubled it up.
Yeah.
So we put two on there, and they're tied at knots on both ends. So it is really, it is literally two weed eater lines doubled up. Only barely more visible to the ground with the sky in the background. Not visible at all if trees or anything are in the background.
But yeah.
If it's just bald sky, you can see it, but still pretty invisible.
Yeah.
To the point where neighbors, when I pointed out, say, I never saw that.
Well, it's a direction and people don't look. Well, it's not at eye level.
Yeah, that's true. It's not someplace people are going to be looking. But they only see it if I literally point it out.
Yeah.
You know the deal with literally?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I know it's overused when people don't.
Well, incorrectly used.
Yeah.
But the definition has changed.
The definition has changed?
Yeah. If you look in the dictionary, some of the dictionaries that are a little more progressive than others.
The definition, it's
between literally and virtually. You know, literally is supposed to be, yes, this is the way things are. Virtually is, it's kind of like that, but not quite. But literally now is an exaggerated version of virtually. I mean, it still means the original definition, but it also now means it. And if somebody says, my head literally exploded.
They're using the new definition.
You know that they know their head didn't explode. So they are using it for exaggeration. So that's the way things are. Language is flexible. Resistance is futile.
Yeah, well, you know, when the correctness of, say, physical facts is determined by popular opinion, I'll have a lot more to say about it.
Yeah. Some people, though, they get all bent out of shape about language.
Yeah.
When language changes.
And it's because they haven't read the new revised dictionary.
From the mailbag. Real, literally came in the mail. Gary Kahn for IQ, I just wanted to thank you for all your efforts in producing the amateur radio-related videos. It's obvious you enjoy and are good at what you do. So there.
Wow.
So there. I can appreciate the time and effort that you put into the production of these videos. Also, the cost of equipment alone has to be very substantial, to say the least. Jeff, it is literally very expensive. both in the actual and the exaggerated.
Actually, I brought
versions.
My own drink today.
All right, so thank you. I just finished watching the video with Riley Hollingsworth at the Winston-Salem Club meeting, which Cindy pointed out that the club is actually the Forsyth Amateur Radio Club.
Yeah.
Which, in the three or four times I said it in the introduction to that program, one time I got it kind of right, and the rest I said Forsyth. The Forsyth Amateur Radio Club. It is Forsyth. Clear emphasis on the Scythe. I'm not a North Carolina native. I moved down here 25 years ago. I'm beginning to get the language.
Yeah.
Y'all. Do you know what the plural of y'all is?
All y'all.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Y'all sounds like it's plural, but y'all is singular.
Yeah, I can tell you're not from around here. And not just because you got the emphasis on the wrong syllable.
Yeah. Not from around here.
Yeah.
I just finished watching the video with Riley Hollingsworth at the Winston-Salem Club meeting. Very informative. Always like to hear Riley's sensible approach to amateur radio's problems and issues. Your videos present a different venue of amateur radio-related subjects and areas of interest. I've watched some of the other amateur radio videos and programs. I like Randy, K7AGE's videos, and George Thomas's stuff on amateur logic, but I have difficulty in watching Ham Nation. A certain host... This is something that I have commented on in the past, and I'm glad to see that I am being validated by at least one other ham out there. A certain host talks to us like we are children, and that, to me, is demeaning. So he is polite. He's not seeing who it is. And there's two candidates, the other two guys on the show, Gordon West and Bob Heil. Gordon is... The phrase I like to use, Gordon, is lovable goofball. He plays a little bit being a clown some of the time, and that's his style. It's the way he engages his audience. I don't think there's a problem at all. To me, Bob is Mr. Rogers, and that's Bob, and he's not going to change either. You know, and you know, there's people who don't like the way I am on the TV either. They don't like that Gary guy on their TV. They like Jeff. I'm not running to anybody that doesn't like you. But there's a few that don't like me. Anyway, so you know, it's you pays your money or you don't pays your money, as the case may be, and you take your choice. But this is from Don WB3CEH. So you know, he and I think that Bob is just a little too avuncular for our tastes. What was that word you hit me with the other day? A technical term of some kind.
Oh, I didn't know. Just can't remember.
Yeah, avuncular. the root is uncle, as in the man from Uncle. Avuncular is your lovable old uncle.
Oh.
You know, pats you on the head, gives you some candy.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we like that guy.
Yeah. Bet that's Bob.
He's never patted me on the head or given me candy.
No. Your productions are informative. I live in Western Pennsylvania, not exactly a hotbed of amateur radio innovation. I'll bet there's some hams in Western Pennsylvania that would like to disagree with that. Your videos have enlightened me on what's happening with digital voice, not just D-Star, but the other endeavors. I have enclosed a money order for $25 toward your costs and efforts in producing the videos. I do have costs and, well, efforts is, I guess, the key word. The salary. I pay myself. I take money out of, you know, go to McDonald's and buy the Happy Meal and stuff like that. Just like you do. He sent a money order. He says, I don't do PayPal, which is fine. A lot of people don't do PayPal. Didn't want me to have the hassle of an out-of-state personal check. So he sent the money order. He hopes that's okay. It's fine. It goes to the bank just like anything else. But an out-of-state personal third-party double endorsed check is fine. The bank eventually clears them as well. As a side note, I noticed that I use a small one-handed camcorder in some of the videos. I'd appreciate if I could give some input. He's looking to buy a basic camcorder for occasional videos like vacations. He has found the Canon Vixia HF R500 HD, about $200 is a possible choice. What do I think? I have no idea. The camera that I hold in my hand is the one that's pointed at Jeff right now. So it's sitting over there. Let's see. I'm going to attempt some real-time camera manipulation with my point of view cam. No, that's the point of view cam. This is the, what did I call this? The boom cam. It's a little camera that's, there we go. It's mounted on the microphone boom. So it's the only thing that I've got that is actually mobile and flexible. So I'm going to swing it around. I'll show you the problem I'm having. Come on, there we go. I'm going to swing it around. Notice how directional Bob's mics are? They're pretty darn good.
Yeah.
I use his mics. There we go. There's the little camera. It's sitting up there on the tripod. That's the one that's pointed at Jeff. And you are getting dizzy.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Tighten this down again so it doesn't go turning away from me.
You're disturbing the bear.
You know, I don't even know what model camera that is. I have no idea. I got that camera at Best Buy when I was out in Seattle because one of those cameras that's sitting behind you, it's out of frame. You can grab one and pull it down in. Yeah, hold it right in front of your face. So, yeah. Those are the B camera, B and C cameras that I've been using. They run on tape. They run on the HDV tape. Yeah. And I had one die. One had died before I left, and one died while I was there. I was testing things out in the hotel room the night before.
I knew one had been acting up.
Yeah, and it decided to stay dead. So I ran to Best Buy and I bought another one real quick. It was $600. I have some specific requirements for cameras that most people don't have. I want them to have an external audio input, and that's kind of it. it was the first camera that I bought that didn't record on tape. It recorded on a high density SD card.
No.
And I had been avoiding those, and now that's all I want to use. You know, was forced into modernizing, and so now I don't want to use any tape anymore.
Yeah.
I like the idea of recording on the...
Who can blame you?
Yeah. The tape does give you a permanent archive, assuming you don't reuse the tape, but it's... they're big, and I've got an archive sitting in a closet that's taken up an awful lot of room. These days, what I do is I record on the little card, and I copy it to two terabyte mobile USB hard drives.
Mm-hmm.
They cost $100 a piece. They'll take a lot of stuff, 2 terabytes. And when they're full, put them on the shelf.
Yeah.
And I do it to two because eventually one of them is going to stop working.
Right.
But the other one probably will. And the odds of going back to that stuff, I've never gone back to the tape. And the odds of going back to the hard drives for that stuff, because you erase the SD card and use that again.
Yeah.
Pretty small.
That's pretty cool.
For a vacation, any high-definition camera in the $200 range is going to do fine. The things you run into in the last episode where we were playing the audio from Adam, from his the video on his Indiegogo, with the folks that were sitting back off of the microphone. In, where am I going here? They're sitting way back off their microphone and the hollowness of the room and sounding off mic and all. This mic is probably too good. I probably sounded just fine.
It dropped off some.
Okay.
But did it
sound reverbing?
Okay. Yeah.
So, I mean, those are the things you run into. And if you're going to use a microphone on the camera, don't get 20 feet away. Get 2 feet away if someone's going to talk. If you're just going to pick up random stuff. And if you can't get close, you can't get close. What can you do?
Yeah.
But those are the things that are important to me. Almost anybody's making a good enough camera these days. If the camera in your phone isn't good enough. You know, it's all high def. I think I'd stay away from the 4K, UHD and the 4K stuff for now. You don't really need it for home movies. The playback equipment is not really available for it. You would start archiving your stuff as 4K, but you'd have a hard time getting it to play on anything you've got right now, except for the camera. So, in fact, I'm not even sure they're selling those little cameras in 4K yet. Probably they are. They're selling phones in 4K.
What's 4K?
Well, high definition video is 1920 by 1080, so approximately 2K, 2,000 pixels wide, by 1080 high, 1920 by 1080. I can't do the math in my head. It may be. In any case, it's 4K is twice as much.
4,000 pixels wide.
Yeah.
Holy
As opposed to 2,000. Yeah, 1920, wow. 1,000. The 1920 and 1920 by 1080 is 1,920 pixels wide,
right?
By 1,080 high, yeah. And so 4K is 2,000 pixels wide by 1,000 or so, a little more than 1,000 high. It's still the 16:9 aspect ratio, so it just gets sharper and sharper.
Wow,
this stuff is pretty good. High definition is pretty good. 4K is better. If you got a, you need a pretty big display to make a big deal out of it. Welcome to Home Theater Geeks. I'm your host, the Santa Claus looking guy on Twitch. So anyway, Don WB3CEH, I can't give you a really good recommendation on a camera besides they're pretty much all fine. Even at that low price range, I think you're going to go too wrong. Go to Amazon, look at the camera, look at the reviews at the bottom of the page on Amazon. Throw away the best one. Throw away the worst one, because the best one is from the guy that works at the company, and the worst one is from the competitor.
Yeah.
And the ones in the middle, you know, are going to be...
The real ones.
Yeah, from real users. Let's see. move this over to the screen where I can read it, but I'm not going to put it on screen. I don't do fan mail very much, and I don't talk about the contributors very much because I tend to think I never promised them publicity, but I also never promised them anonymity. So I just haven't said very much. I have promised people that if you send me your email, I won't publish that and I won't give it away. I won't sell it, won't give it away. That's private between you and me. But what they say to me, I don't know. And how much money they give. There's a show that the guys have supported the Kickstarter from the Tapper DCC. It's Adam Curry and the No Agenda show. They spend about a third of the show reading notes from people who contribute money. I think they're onto something there. I think that they encourage people to contribute when they talk about the people who contribute and how much they contribute and the things that they say. I think there may be something to that because it's a 2.5-3 hour show and they probably spend 30 minutes or more talking about those guys. And they get contributions from in every show, they get a few of them at $1,000.
Oh my goodness!
this is a serious business for these guys. They do the show twice a week. They do it on time, and they get it out. They, you know, not like me, which is whenever I can get around to doing one.
Yeah.
So this is their livelihood, or at least a substantial part of their livelihood. So, but it's what they do. So I'll do a little bit of it here.
Okay.
Larry Weaver, N8NJ from Northwood, Ohio. Gary, here's another $10 for the cause, which means he's given before. I personally know of numerous hams affected by HOAs or deed restrictions. So this is right after the show we did on deed restrictions. In fact, the show was from a ham who opposed the idea of the law that is being proposed in Congress that would modify homeowners association restrictions. HB 1080, I think is what it was, or 10.
I might watch that episode to see why he opposes
it. It's a fairly conservative or libertarian view of just not having the federal government stick its nose into what he's considering to be private contracts.
Oh.
So I'm sure there's a point. You know, there is a big point there.
Yeah.
Your contract with your homeowners association, part of your deed, is a private contract. You signed it. That's why the FCC is not sticking their nose into it. That's why PRB1 doesn't apply to it. Something that a lot of hams, even today, don't understand.
No, they wish it would.
Yeah, well, they behave as if it would, and they put up an antenna or a tower or something, and then they're shocked to discover that it doesn't. So, the bill in Congress, in the House right now, which is not going anywhere this year and may or may not go someplace next year. It's a long-term effort. May not ever go someplace, but you know, we're kind of hoping. It would modify homeowners associations to put PRB1 type language into federal law. It wouldn't nullify restrictions based on homeowners associations. It would just require your association to deal with you in a reasonable manner. And what's reasonable? No, that's tell it to the judge.
You can't define that, right?
Yeah, tell it to the judge. Anyway, so this is from N8NJ, $10. Timothy Krumholtz, W8KSC from Amarosa, Iowa. I like the in the booth style interview that we have. So we've done that at Hamfest. We're not doing it so much anymore because we can't afford to go to Hamfest so much. But we did interviews like that quite a bit, and it was kind of neat to bring people into the booth, set up with the mics. I bought the Heil mics because they were such great noise rejection off the back. Because using
Hamfest are noisy places.
So it was kind of neat because you got a lot of people in a Dayton or in Orlando. You got a lot of people that are important in ham radio in one way or another, or interesting if they're not important, and to sit them down and talk to them.
I thought it worked good.
Skype does that, but it's not quite as intimate.
Yeah.
But we'll do more Skype. Anthony Holly or Haley from Falls Church, Virginia. I don't usually donate online, but these videos are just fantastic. Thank you so much for what you do.
Wow.
Holly or Haley? You know the comet guy?
Haley.
That's none of the above. Because they call it Haley's Comet, but isn't his name really Halley?
I don't know how it was pronounced. That just wasn't around.
Astronomical as you are, you don't really know the way to pronounce Halley's Comet.
Disagree on the pronunciation of stars that have been named for many hundreds of years.
And the planetary or not designation of Pluto.
Well, that you know, there never really was a lot of controversy about that.
Which way did they go?
They demoted it. There's 8 planets now.
Okay, so they astronomers in general thought, yeah, Pluto's just a big rock.
Yeah.
And many other big rocks. Yeah. Dean Lamson, VK3FDRL. Yes, I read that right. VK3FDRL, Victoria, Australia. Thanks for the old introductory video. I went ahead and got my license.
Oh, my goodness. Was you that remember? That 1992 one?
Well, 1999.
99.
Yeah. Oh. We made one back around 92, 93. The very goodness. Simple one. Then we made a much more elaborate one back in 99.
Yeah.
And best I can tell from surveying stuff on the web, hasn't been beat.
Oh, my goodness. 15 years.
Introduction to amateur radio is very difficult. First of all, we all think we understand it because we've been doing it, those of us who've been doing it for a while, you know, 10 years or more or so. You qualify in the 10 years or more category. We think we understand it, so we think we can explain it. And we can't. It's hard.
Yeah.
We try to explain it all at once.
Yeah.
We open the fire hose.
It's a shotgun blast of information. Yeah.
Yep. And we start with the least important, most obscure stuff. Well, there's amateur television and satellites. I'm not saying that either of those is not important, but they're just not what people are going to be doing first. So we deliberately concentrated on the first stuff things we'll do. FM, voice,
when I first HF became voice. A ham, I really disliked that hams would say things like when asked concerning the cost of the equipment, well, you can talk all around the world for $35.
Yeah, or for free if you can can take apart an old television set.
But if you give a ham the $35 and say, I want to talk to Japan, then the truth starts to come out. Yes, it's possible. No, you will probably never do it.
So Dean made his first contribution to Ham Radio Now in 2012, and at that time he noted the old introduction show. If you want to find that program, just Google Introduction to Amateur Radio. It won't be the first thing you get, but it'll be in the first 4 or 5. It'll be on the front page. Okay, I'll take that as a challenge, Jeff.
A challenge?
Yeah.
Oh, how to find it? Okay.
There it is. I need Google. Give me the Google.
I never used it.
You use Dogpile, right?
Yeah.
Jeez. Okay,
ARRL is top. That's the third one.
Yep, there we go. ARRL is top. Ham Universe is number 2, and there we are at number 3. And, well, that's interesting. I don't know why I brought up that page. That's not the page that I would have brought up. Because that's not showing you the actual video.
Nope. I don't see it.
That is a little weird. So okay, so if you're going to that page, then you're going to have to go down here to find it under other stuff that I've done. What the heck, Jeff?
Well, it's a good thing you looked. There it is. Just before a ham's night before Christmas in green.
Right just there. After.
Yeah, after.
Just after.
Okay. Before, after, you know.
Yeah, there we go. And I apologize. For some reason, I thought that I needed to have a long explanation of what this was as text. So there's this fairly long scroll. You can skip past a bunch of it.
If you could have keystoned it, it would have been just like, you know, Star Wars.
That would have been cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. So eventually that ends, and I believe this will be the end. Jeez.
As I was saying, this is the class. It's great to see so many folks here. I have a little...
Remember what I said about not using camera-mounted microphones?
When we teach this class, is we begin with a demonstration.
Wow, look how big the class was.
It was huge. Yeah.
Some of you don't know too much about it. So to get everybody up to speed, we like to do a demonstration.
Look at those extra 40 pounds around my gut.
Yeah, yeah.
To do the demonstration.
Yep, you've done really well.
And I heard him on the radio earlier, but he's not here. And I'm not sure where he is. So I guess what we'll do is we'll just switch things around. Oh, there you go. Jeff!
Oh, hi, Gary. I'm sorry. I was just listening to 20 meters. Oh, hey, everybody.
Remember how we did that? There.
Jeff, the class is tonight. You're supposed to be here.
Yep. That was fun. That was a long time ago. Yeah. That's when you still would edit.
I still edit. Oh, I still edit. Boy, do I still edit.
Oh.
So anyway, that was, those were shot at totally different times. That wasn't what it looked like, was me talking to you. That was a video playing back in the little video player. I carefully timed for my introductory comments.
Practiced.
Yeah, I practiced for once or twice.
Oh.
I'm good. I'm a natural-born talent.
Okay.
Okay, so he liked that show, and he... okay, back... Where did we go? Oh, it's up here on the big screen. Come on. There we go. So, VK... Where did his call sign go? There it goes. VK3FDRL. That looked strange to me.
Yeah.
So I was thinking, what's the deal with that? And it turns out that for Australia, I did a little bit of research, there are some four-letter suffixes. And the first letter in, I think, everybody's, but if somebody from Australia can correct me on that, I think the first letter in everybody's suffix, although there may be some grandfather licenses that don't do this, indicates the class.
License class.
Yeah, license class. It got advanced, standard, and foundation. So an F indicates a foundation class license. And there's a... There's a long list of prefixes that indicate what the other classes are. It's not just one single prefix. So quite a different way to do things.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
William Owens, 85EW, Dallas, Texas, or Bill. Really like SDR, Flex, and DV coverage. Don Gover, KC9ZMY in Chicago. Just finished up watching Riley. And partway through the Tapper one with Bruce. Again, I want to let you know how much I appreciate that you take the time to do this. I look forward to the next installment of Ham Radio Now in my YouTube channels. Take care. Have a wonderful Thanksgiving. Don has made several large contributions since we got started. And he's either emailed or included a note commenting on the quality of the programs with most of the contributions. By large, I mean like $50. So,
wow.
Serious.
Nice.
Big stuff. Richard Gelber, K2WR, New York City. Nice job. And he qualifies his credentials for saying that by saying that he is a 42-year broadcast professional. Somebody in the biz.
Wow.
Thinks we're doing okay. Okay, moving on to a new topic. This, you know, we've been going on much longer than I thought we would. So
okay.
Split this into two programs. Now is too late to split it into two programs, but we'll see. An article on EHAM suggested a method for reviving 146.5.2.
Okay.
We all, or as many people as are willing to do it, have a little voice keyer. So take somebody either building a project or a manufacturer building something simple. Mm-hmm. Go on the line with your microphone. A little keyer. Your voice keyer that just says CQ 146.5.2, this is KN4AQ mobile, and is programmed to go off every minute or two as you're heading down the highway.
Yeah.
Because the deal is you're on the interstate, and there's a chance that somebody else is going to be within range of you going down the interstate,
right.
But you're never going to know.
Yeah. Right.
When we drive to Dayton, we run into that. Somewhere about 150 miles out, we usually run into some folks on 5-2, either already talking or we'll make some noise and we'll pick up somebody because mm-hmm. people are concentrating on their way right. in. But just going down the road, any old random interstate, maybe, maybe not. So if yeah, we're that all, would doing, be interesting. All doing that little beacon thing then and listening on 5-2, those of us particularly who have dual band radios that can listen on two frequencies at once, so we can still be doing whatever else it is that we want to do. But leave one sitting on 5-2. And instead of having to pick up the mic every minute and do something, it's automatically going off.
So that
you'll
sounds
hear,
like
you'll
fun.
Hear somebody.
Yeah, that would yeah. be interesting.
About the only thing I can think of about it that would be a problem is a guy in a base station likes to monitor 5-2. He's going to go nuts.
For 10 minutes.
Well, I mean, if it got somewhat popular.
Oh, lots of people did.
He's going to be hearing yeah. people for not 3-4 miles around, but for 20 miles around.
Yeah.
You know, and it's going to go off like crazy. So.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that may be a problem, but
you could, you'd have to take a poll of your viewers to see how many monitor 5-2.
Yeah, how many of you guys listen on 5-2? I don't know. Okay, the last thing in the show. At a previous Ham Radio Now video.
Good thing you didn't make two.
Yeah, well, at that point, anyway. At a previous Ham Radio Now, maybe an old ARVN video. From Dayton, we did something called Jeff's Telegraphy Corner.
Yeah.
Maybe, I forget if it was Telegraphy Corner or Telegraphy Minute.
Gary said I could do Jeff's Telegraphy Moment here at Dayton, so I want to show you a couple of the unusual telegraph keys we found here at the Hamvention.
Yeah, I can't Jeff's remember. Jeff's Telegraphy something. We'll call this Jeff's Telegraphy Corner. Name That Tune Edition.
Name That Tune Edition?
Yes. This is Jeff's Telegraphy Corner, Name That Tune Edition. And it's also going to be subtitled Good Fist, Bad Fist.
Okay, what are we
doing? This is all on you. You are going to have to avert your gaze because I'm going to have to put something on the screen. And if you see it on the screen, you will know the name of that tune.
Okay.
So avert your eyes. Name this tune. Okay, what did they send, first of all?
I don't know. but
hear
it
again?
Was, I'm trying to think of the name of the tunes. Something Race. It was from a video game. It wasn't Death Race. It was, I just can't remember. But it was a video game where the car comes out of the back of a truck.
Well, it might have been off. It might have been the soundtrack for that. But nope. That's not what it came from.
Okay, where'd it come from?
Let me play it up to where the actual music is. I think they're going to sing at some point. You're tuned to the mighty sound of the Big 500. 500 kilohertz, that is. Your national distress frequency. All CW, all the time. Brought to you by the Coast Guard and the Merchant Marine. Here are the B-52s.
She drove a Plymouth satellite, a faster than the speed of light.
I can't play too much of it or I'll get yanked from YouTube.
Yeah.
So let's go back to the beginning and tell us what they send.
I'll need to write that.
It's too fast for you? I mean, it's something DE something, and they're not ham call signs.
Nope.
But what happened was I was listening to one of the streaming music deals, and I was looking for stuff to put in the playlists. And, you know, I liked Love Shack, which is the B-52's big song.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And so I just brought them up and I said, oh, Planet Clear. I think I know what that is. I'll stick that in there. But I didn't listen to it. And so the thing was playing. I was working out the other day and the thing was playing in the headphones. And this Morse code comes on. What is that? How did I put that in there? And it's too fast for me to copy.
The first Morse code I ever heard just in the wild was in a video game called Castle Wolfenstein.
That was the predecessor to Doom.
Oh.
I think.
Oh.
I think it was. Yeah. And so I didn't play that, although it was embedded in Doom as an Easter egg someplace. If you hit the right thing, went through the right door or something, suddenly you're in Castle Wolfenstein.
Yeah.
But I didn't hear the
message code. Didn't make sense, though. It was real text in English, but it didn't have anything to do with the game.
Okay. All right. Avert your gaze one more time. We'll try one more here. And this is going to be cool. If it gets going, here, there we go. Got the record. I'm playing this on my record player. We can all recognize that, I think. You can snap your fingers if you want. Have you heard this? Have you ever heard this?
Never. Nope. Over the air, I don't think I ever have.
Okay, you can look again.
So you don't know just what it means. Dust your shoes off, shake out your jeans. Get on your feet, jump
the
to the beat.
The VE2QS Orchestra.
Yeah, I'll freeze the picture so you can see what it looks like.
Uh-oh.
What?
No, it's wrong here. Da-di-da-di-da-di-da-da.
No, da 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 da.
Look here.
Oh, da 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 da. CY Serenade. CY Serenade. Da 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 da. That's Y, right?
So it's CQ Serenade. Yeah, right.
we're just changing it.
Huh.
Okay, so.
Okay. No, never heard that before.
Attention, RPM Canada 1971, your YouTube page is incorrect. Yeah, I came across that a long time ago, and there's versions of it out there that don't have the record scratch in the beginning. And I just happened to search this up when I was looking for something that I could make a picture with and play here on Jeff's Telegraphy Corner.
Wow! Yeah.
Name that tune edition.
Yeah, you probably shouldn't do that again.
and there it was. Okay, there's a couple more things here. Okay, avert your gaze once again and see if you can recognize this one.
This is Ham Nation, episode number 15, recorded August 30th, 2011, when all else fails.
Well, come on, you know what show it's from.
Hey, everybody.
Yeah, I know what show it's from, but...
Okay, you can look at it.
Okay.
I'm proud of waste part. Time out.
Because I'm not sure if it's a legitimate thing to say that we're on the air.
No.
I need an official reading on this. Leo, W6TWT, this is KN4AQ. Do you copy? Over.
I copy you, KN4AQ. I think we're not on the air. We're more like on the packets. I don't know what we call it. We're on the...
Yes, that's one of my old Ham Nations I'm proud of.
Yeah.
Because it was me and Leo. And Leo doesn't know me from a hole in the ground anymore, but I was there.
Yeah, that was fun.
Yeah, I was there. Okay, so there's one more thing as I was trying to hunt up stuff. This won't be, you don't have to avert your gaze this time.
I can gaze.
You can gaze, because this is, I was just searching YouTube. I think the terminology was Morse code music. To see what would come up. And this next thing came up.
As we all know, rock and roll is made by Satanists intent on hiding subversive messages in their devil music. But what if I told you that all musicians are in fact colossal nerds, and all those subversive messages are in Morse code?
Not sure I can quite copy that.
Morse code was first developed in 1836, the creation of numerous minds beyond just namesake and cool haircut Samuel Morse. It cemented its value during the Second World War as a method of radio communication and remained the maritime emergency distress standard until 1999.
I think you got that part wrong. He said Second World War, and I'm pretty sure it was around in the First World War.
It was around in the Civil War.
Yeah, radio wasn't, but telegraphy
right,
was.
Right. Yeah. So. I love you, gay.
SOS, which to be clear is just a meaningless string of letters and not actually an acronym, is the most recognizable piece of the code, which mixes dots and dashes and can be understood both audibly and visually. Like when Katy Perry...
So isn't this like super cool?
New record.
Yeah, that's cool.
Since its completion in 1956, the light at the top of LA's iconic Capitol Records building has been blinking out Hollywood.
The light on the top was in Morse code spelling out Hollywood.
I didn't either.
In fact, I think Mrs. Morse threw the switch originally. I assumed the light was required for aircraft, and so they decided, oh, let's make it spell out Hollywood.
But a month before the official announcement of Katy Perry's Prism, it started blinking out the album's title and release date. No one noticed. And that led Carson
to call
Katy Perry a sneaky genius.
Okay, so if you want to go watch the rest of that, you can on your own.
Okay, I think I will.
That's what it is, Secret Morse Code Messages in Music. But I want to go to the very end of it.
Shot at the night. Not as committed as
Katy Perry. Because there's something a little bit special.
And way less committed than Rush. Have you guys ever used Morse Cloud? There's a link in the description, but basically it's a website that lets you input text and then outputs the result in Morse code and uploads it to SoundCloud. So please mess around with it and share the results in the comments. And let us know if you even think Morse code is going to be around in the next 10 years.
Ooh.
Subscribe for new...
Oh, those are fake words. Because this was how long ago? Is there a date on it? It was published earlier this year, so... Yeah, we'll see, 10 years. I mean, I got a feeling it's still going to be around.
There's equipment made today that uses it in has it in the firmware.
Yeah,
what is... Given error codes and so forth.
But that Morse... what did he say it was? Morse Cloud? It's gone. MorseCloud.com, the thing that would translate and put them into SoundCloud, that appears to be gone. If you go to it, you just get a bunch of those, a page that's got a bunch of links. So someone's collecting money off of it somewhere. But the rest of this little video has something that's cool in it.
Episodes of this exist every week, and stick around through the subscription button to hear Toto's Africa rendered in Morse code.
Copy that?
Yeah. But I already know the words.
Yeah, it becomes easier when you know what's coming. Tell people the code free among us or the code challenged, what he just sent.
That I picked it up at the rain when I realized it.
I bless the rains in Africa. Totos, you know, Africa. I bless the rain down in Africa.
Yeah, oh yeah, I remember the song. What fun.
Okay, so that is it for Jeff's Telegraphy Corner, or Moment, or Minute.
Well, that wasn't very exciting.
Name That Tune Edition, and... I forgot.
I failed miserably.
I forgot.
Sorry. Most egregiously.
I forgot the subtitle, Good Fist, Bad Fist. How many good fists did you hear?
I thought they were all pretty good.
Yeah. The only one that was...
The easiest to copy was the last one.
The only one that wasn't particularly good... was the Ham Nation one that Joe Walsh did, because he was syncopating it to the beat of the music, to precisely timed Morse code. I mean, it's easy to copy. It wasn't very fast. He was just sending H-A-H-A-M, H-A-M.
Yeah.
Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. It was the kind of swing that a lot of hams put into their Morse sending.
Yeah. Yeah, and when you're trying to do, you know, like Ben's Best Bent Wire, if sent with a good fist, it doesn't have that musical swing that it has.
It don't mean a thing.
Right.
If it ain't got that swing. All right. That's it.
And if people have never tried it, send Ben's Best Bent Wire. It's pretty interesting.
Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Yeah.
Almost, yeah.
Okay. So I think we're done.
Okay.
All right. Let me remind everybody once again that Arvin, the chief financial officer of Ham Radio Now, is sitting back there overseeing the entire proceedings quietly. He wasn't saying much, was he?
No, he's probably drunk. He's got the naked pig beer.
I haven't noticed that the cap is not. If he's whoa! I don't know if you can hear that. I think we're being strafed. This is not a soundproof studio. If he's been tippling, you know, it's siphoning a little bit here and there. I haven't checked to see if the cap is securely fastened. I don't think it's one of those twist-off caps, though. I think it's.
Yeah, I think you're right.
It would show signs of manipulation. So we're probably okay with Arvin.
Okay.
But he does invite you to support the program. I can't see any reason why you would at this point. But in case you do, that website, once again, is hamradionow.tv. Hamradionow.tv. You'll see Arvin's little icon. It's just that picture that you see right. It's there, I think. And you click on that, and PayPal, a major credit card. You can send a check in the mail or a postal money order, and keep us in bits.
Okay.
Hard drive space.
All right.
Routers, things like that.
Let's wrap it.
All right. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ,
and I'm still Jeff Wittick, AC4ZO.
Over
and out.
You want to take a guess?
Oh, 52.
Passed 52 in the rearview mirror a long time ago.
Uh-oh.